Good afternoon, everyone. I think we will make this session, lively and interesting as a last parting note of this, I think, very interesting conference throughout the day you were having. So our topic of discussion is, as we are finding everywhere in every, whether it is a security forum or it is innovations or digital transformation forums of the financial services world, blockchain is the key buzzword. And inspired by that, actually, our today's topic is blockchain as a risk management and data security as an emerging technology approach with respect to KYC and transactions. So as we know that by the name of the blockchain, with the basic understanding of the blockchain definition, the first thing comes in our mind, since it is a immutable, definitely it should be secure, and it should be fit for the our risk management needs, such as the KYC process. So I think the key need is that we need to understand with our esteemed panelists that whether it is a right technology, what is this blockchain, and what are the different use cases are for this technology, and how it could be useful for the risk management oriented business processes. So as our panelists have been introduced, so I will first go to Prasanna. I have been told by our all panelists that he is the right now mostly experimenting with this technology, and among us he is the best practitioner. So I will first address this question to Prasanna.
Once again, thanks Business World for this opportunity to come here and talk about this mainstream technology nowadays, blockchain. So blockchain, as of now, the way we are discussing, I think it's coming out of that awareness stage. People are doing lots of POCs and pilots and getting into the actual implementation. But if you look at the blockchain, is something like an operating system. Okay, just like in the way we had these MS-DOS operating systems in way back in 82s. And that time also we were very happy that this is one of the best operating systems at that point in time.
Right.
But you have seen the journey of MS-DOS, which has now become very well of good operating system like Windows. Similarly, we talk about Linux and so on. So that's how is the blockchain as of now. A lot to do as a standardization and making the whole technology robust. And a lot of work is happening on that. So if you look at current stage of blockchain, in India specifically, a lot of banks are doing the proof of concepts and pilots. I think along with SBI Bank, who has laid this bank chain kind of a platform, almost there are more than 26 banks as members to that.
Yeah.
So wherein what we have done, almost we have experimented more than 10 use cases. One of them is in AML, KYC and so on. So banks, as a one of the pillar of this whole ecosystem of blockchain, they are very well aware this is very important. Take example, why? Because in over a period of next 5-6 years, we're going to invest a lot on infrastructure. For example, UPI kind of a system, we'll invest on WebSphere, we'll invest on that middleware like a PSP, and we'll invest in something on NPC, a trust agency, as well as there will be a lot of thing on the mobile side. So just imagine all your this implementation at the bank side, both the beneficiary as well as the remitter bank and the trust agency, everything is in a nutshell in a one PC, which is a blockchain.
Right.
And if you look at just an example, Bitcoin is one of the example of a blockchain. The data size of a complete Bitcoin is somewhere around 120 GB, which is as good as your data of your PC. So this is the what I am saying, the all the transaction set which is happening since 2008.
Right.
Right? So that's the one of the advantages that will save a lot of on the infrastructure side. So banks are aware this is the thing which you can do with the help of blockchain. There are various use cases you will see. Where it will get out of this man in middle or reconciliation kind of or settlement kind of things, where lot of efforts goes in operation. Like we have those operation units for, only for that purpose. Some of the clearing units has a, one of the responsibilities of the banks. We will get rid of that, but everything is automatic. It's although it is a journey. Apart from banks, the service providers, take example, Infosys or TCS or Accenture, everybody is practicing that. They have understood that this is a need of a time. So recently, I was fortunate to experience the all the presentation of all the major service providers, including IBM, who is spearheading this kind of experimentation along with Infosys has done some experiment along with ICICI Emirates, or Monetago, which has done some experiment initially with IDRBT and SBI, PNB. Or you talk about some of the experiments which has been done at S-Bank or Ripple and Axis Bank. So all these, or R3, so all these people are aware that this has to be, work has to be done. So the banks are, corporates or big companies are working or practicing the blockchain. And if you see the number of startups we were having in the last to last year in blockchain space and today, so maybe hardly 10 startups were there in 2 years before. And today almost every new startup talks about a blockchain to do something, their own ICO or something. So these three angles, and followed by even internally, banks are doing lots of awareness programs so that internal stakeholders also can come up with the various use cases. And finally, the government. Just an example of recently, Andhra government is doing their complete land registry on a blockchain.
Yes.
And so I would say these four pillars are really understood the importance of blockchain. That's how this journey is going on.
Great.
And finally, the various fabrics or operations, that's also improving.
Right.
So that's a stage as of now. We'll hear from others also.
Yeah. So Arijit, actually, I heard that with the, one of the leading bank, you know, outside India, IBM has done a you know, successful pilot, and very soon that bank is also going to production or already gone to production. So could you, you know, shed more light that you know, whether this blockchain technology is good for the regulatory business processes like KYC or AML, and similarly, you know, what are the other use cases you are observing in the industry and you are working with various other banks?
I think 2016 was the year where there was a lot of interest generated around blockchain, right? And IBM has been working with financial institutions across the globe, and I will come to some stories in India. 2017 first half was all about POCs, and 2017 second half and going ahead in 2018, we will actually see a lot of this going into production. So let me just take a few examples. Let me start with the most recent one. Last week, we announced a banking blockchain solution for the entire South Pacific, including Australia, New Zealand, and UK, where these banks would be able to do cross-border remittances, right? This was not possible earlier. Now, if you really look at it, this really helps, for example, a buyer in a distant island in Pacific to really talk to a trader in a country like Indonesia. Right, and what it is doing is it is helping the entire settlement times to be much reduced, and it is making the cost of every transaction, every payment transaction, much lower. Right, this entire blockchain actually today is live. It is actually operating across 12 currencies across all these countries. For example, if a farmer has to trade with someone in some other country, that farmer is able to actually put up all the collaterals. There is the rules of the contract defined, the trade documentation is handled, the LCs could be opened, which, so for the banks, it is opening up new markets. The entire global de-risking, which is happening nowadays, which is keeping away a lot of emerging economies from the global financial system, is getting taken care of. This. So this is one example. The second one, which we have done recently, around a couple of months back, was with 7 multinational banks established a trade finance digital platform in Europe, where all these banks are able to work with their SMEs, and IBM worked with these banks to really develop the front end for the SMEs in the area of trade finance. Coming back home, closer to home today, we have examples where banks and financial institutions have set up their entire supply chain on the blockchain, and I'm sure you can talk more about it. So that's the one. The Singapore government recently published a prototype where they worked with, again, around 5 banks for the entire central KYC. So today, they are actually having the customer information, including all the information about the customer, which is available on the blockchain, which could then be shared with all the other stakeholders, right? And they have also included the tax authorities, the credit bureaus, and a lot of government registries, like he spoke about land records. So what we are seeing today, Shiv, is that from the interest to the POCs, things have got actually productionized, not only outside India, back even in our country.
So Mayank, actually, you know, from the Data Security Council of India perspective, have you come across need that you know such technology could be used for the regulatory areas, and how do you see as a you know security and risk technologies expert that for will this be a emerging technology or is it just a hype?
I would rather take a back step here and for audience viewpoint simplify it that what is this enigma of blockchain from a definition perspective. So let's suppose we five people are here, we are part of a kitty party, we five panelists, okay, and Mr. Shiv is the new entrant and to validate whether he's a trusted entrant or not. Earlier models, we used to bring in a third party like a regulator, etc., or a third party, and they will come and vouch for this new entrant. Now, what blockchain will do or is doing, as other panelists has mentioned about use cases, is these four people, with the help of their information which they have collected about the new entrant, will validate whether this new entrant is trusted or not. Okay, why do we do this? They will get incentivized for it. So the trust part, building trust part, and changing risk management landscape is going to change because of blockchain. Okay, because you will remove third parties also to an extent. Maybe there will be a dilution of regulator roles also to an extent. How it would prevail, it will take some time. Even regulators, if you look at in all geographies from India to Russia to US, are somehow finding it difficult that what is the actual role when it comes to blockchain implementations, especially from a public blockchain use case viewpoint. Now, coming back to the question of whether it will overhaul the data security over field or the cybersecurity field, there are solutions in market right now, the capabilities which are based on blockchain, and they are delivering cybersecurity solutions. I'll talk about one organization which is an Indian startup, and since there are many startups coming up, called Block Armor. Okay, what they have done is they have put software-defined perimeter on blockchain. So earlier, software-defined perimeter used to be on a centralized system. Now they are saying that critical sector organizations such as from banks or BFSI or ONGC, so as to say oil and gas exploration, can have blockchain-defined perimeter. So the system will deliver more resiliency, there will be no single point of failure. Okay. So, and the Gartners and Forrester are now thinking to create a new category now, that the cybersecurity capability providers would use this platform, okay, to deliver resilient systems. And they would also take give changes to how risk management had been classically being done. Second part of the question, take a back step again, that there is a myth going on, and we were speaking also offline about it, that blockchain is unhackable or immutable. Okay. So I would like to clarify that if you talk from a centralization system view perspective, the threat surfaces which were applicable on central systems may not apply on blockchain system because it's decentralized. Yes, it is more resilient, but recent attacks, examples such as what happened in case of Ethereum, the DAO attack, which happened a year back, and it happened because within the smart contracts of Ethereum, there were weak codes. Okay, ultimately, you are going to code also in blockchain systems. And millions of Ether were stolen. So some traditional vulnerabilities of centralized systems would also haunt blockchain systems. Okay, and there will be some new vulnerabilities which we will be introduced to. For example, we were never introduced to an attack called 51% attack, right? So that means if we four collude together and we say that we don't want Mr. Shiv in this blockchain system, then or we want to even dominate what he's trying to do in this blockchain network, we can do that because we are more than 51%, right? So it can happen in public blockchain implementation also and private blockchain implementation also. So these are certain examples of how cybersecurity, data security, risk management, and then new attack surface is going to change in the blockchain world.
Very wonderful. Actually, we always had a thought that you know, this is a secure technology and being immutable. So there are as ultimately the chains or links get built by the programmers. So there are also in the coding the vulnerabilities may cause the issues. So do you see Mayank, that any kind of a SOP or the standard bodies are there in the blockchain where these, well, just like when you are coding the web applications, so there are web application security standards are there. So in the world of blockchain, are there some security standards are establishing or already established?
They are actually doing one project only on blockchain security and privacy controls. Okay, so India as a geography is taking a lead in setting up standards also when it comes to protecting blockchain from a cybersecurity and data privacy viewpoint. But we can also look towards the external world and learn from best practices, which had been a case also for our geography. South Korea has set a deadline now that in 2 years they'll come out with an international standard on blockchain cybersecurity. Okay. In 2 years, a lot of things will change, and in 2 years, I think we will see a lot of industrial use cases coming out, which are really giving efficient profits or improving the bottom lines because of blockchain implementation. Okay, and I think if we catch up on that race of adopting those standards which are prevailing internationally, as compared to what we did traditionally in cybersecurity, then yes, and we become leader also with how BankChain is providing. They have already come out with a standard document on what controls can be built into a blockchain system from a security viewpoint and a privacy viewpoint so that it is more robust. It is robust for an enterprise. It is robust from a consumer perspective.
Right. So that's very
just
good
to add inputs. In the backend, we use either any of the fabric, right?
Right.
So how do we make a standardization of the fabric as well as considering the security angle? So MIT has done some kind of a workshop along with Microsoft, IBM, and so many other providers of so that, and they are going to do it regularly. So just like in W3C has given us an output of a HTTPS.
Yes.
So similar angle, we will see some output come as far as the security is concerned. Cybersecurity is one of the subset of a security.
Right. So basically, this is as we are discussing, this is a emerging area,
yes.
And POCs are happening, and standard bodies are also looking at these vulnerabilities from various angles as well. And as we started with that, PC80 and PCXT and PC80 were the first generation, computers when the PC personal computers which we saw. And from then, those days, the OS, many enhancements have happened. So in this technology as well, this is at something similar stage, and various standards and security bodies will be working on standardizing the various aspects of this technology. So now comes, I think, one of the another architectural aspects, which I would like to ask from Suresh. Given, this is when we talk about KYC or when we talk about any other use cases, as Arijit was mentioning about remittances or trade finance or supply chain, where maximum POCs have been done across the world. In SBI as well, we have carried out a pilot for the remittances between Nepal and India. And you would be very surprised to know that Nepal did not have any payment scheme like NEFT, RTGS, so SBI has set up a similar body like NPCI in India to have a you know, payment processing as a settlement body across the all Nepal local banks, and we have done the POC using blockchain technology on that as well. So we are looking at going putting it on production, but that's where the question comes, that is this technology scalable? So that is the question I have with Suresh. What are his views on that?
Good evening, everyone. Part of Mahindra's, we started blockchain for more to use for supply chain, which they do globally. And they started initiating getting the documents. In good olden days, they take more than 6 months to 1.5 years. Where some of the documents, even after verifying, testing it out, it takes more in terms of cost and effectiveness. So whether this particular customer is reliable or this customer can give back that money. So getting all those things today, at least with the selected, we are able to make it properly. And it is having its own like IoT related issues where that security is a challenge again getting connected, information flourishing, checking it out. But once that particular information we are able to trace it out and confirmed, then it comes easy for us to use blockchain more on that. But again, it's a long way. It's try to do it. But as of now, at least Mahindra has confirmed to the suppliers to say no more taking delays in terms of settling their money. They've created some slogan like within a week's time, they'll ensure that the supply chain money gets to that other component party also.
Great.
I think one more important thing is the entire traceability. Mm-hmm. What blockchain really allows you, one is transparency, but the other thing is traceability. Right? For example, the entire Bangladesh incident which happened, which I saw got discussed multiple times in the earlier panels, almost $80 to $100 million of funds could not be traced finally. Right? A blockchain system could have actually helped you trace the transfer of funds or the entire money audit trail till the last mile. So traceability is one important thing. And this is not only getting, while I know this is a financial sector forum, traceability is also happening in the area of food safety, which is so important, right? Which directly concerns with health of people. Right? Today there are consortiums of FMCG companies, Walmart and IBM, where we are able to trace the source of contaminated food within a few seconds. Earlier, which took weeks or days, is happening within a few seconds. So you have the various stakeholders, the farmers, the warehouse, the transportation, the retailer. So the entire traceability of the contaminated food is happening in seconds today. So there are use cases even outside the financial services industry.
Yeah, actually disintermediation as well as the traceability that has improved the end-to-end attack of the various business processes using this technology. But at the same time, still I think we are carrying out the POCs, looking at the scalability. Like in case of State Bank of India, if we want to deploy this technology for KYC, we have every day 120,000 customers onboarded. And for roughly, if we say 30% is the success rate, so that means 3 times of the applications are given or applied for the onboarding the customer, and they get rejected on various counts and all. So for such a high rate, as well as existing customer base would also have 3 to 5% of the KYC details getting updated, is a very conservative estimate for such a large bank. So which has a 550 million customers. So given those volumes, whether this technology will be able to sustain that kind of a concurrency or throughput requirement, it is yet to be established. We have to do the POCs, and some places in some of the implementation the throughput has been observed 10K, 10 TPS, and some people, my fellow panelists, were mentioning that couple of 1,000 TPS as well in certain frameworks it has been implemented. So I think this is an area where I think we have to carry out POC, and as I think technology is maturing, we see that in next 6 to 12 months it is getting that aspect of the architecture aspect addressed, and we have the performance and scalability needs catered by this technology.